Dear students, we are going to continue our second lecture. The topic is same properties or qualities of human language. We have been discussing yesterday human language as a unique phenomenon that is specified only to human beings. Let's have a look at the properties that we are going to discuss today. The first characteristic or quality of human language that we will discuss today is the cultural transmission. Students, we should keep it in mind that language is transferred or transmitted culturally. It is no more inherited by our parents. It is no more acquired by our genes. We learn the language that is present in our environment, or we learn the language that is present in our cultural boundaries. A clear example of it can be taken from our own selves or from the little kids that are around us. For example, most of us belong to Punjabi speaking families, or Punjabi is our mother tongue. We learn language Urdu and English outside from our home culture. Though we focus highly on the acquisition of the Urdu and English, but we learn Punjabi intuitively, or what we can say culturally transmitted. Punjabi is culturally transmitted into ourselves, even if we make no specific effort to acquire that language. Another example can be of some alien member of the society who joins a new culture, but after 3 to 4 months living in that alien culture, he acquired the basic language structure of that language and would be able to communicate in that language. English, that has proved to be a nightmare for our own students, but is learned even by an uneducated person when he starts to live in an English speaking culture, even if the person has not learned it deliberately or from some institution. So we can say that the process whereby a language is passed on from one generation to another generation is a cultural transmission. It is clear that humans are born with some kind of predisposition to acquire language in a general sense. However, we are not born with the ability to produce utterances in specific language such as English. We acquire a first language as children in culture. In the same way, we can say when we may inherit physical features such as brown eyes, dark hair from our parents, we do not inherit our parents' language. We acquire a language in a culture with other speakers, not from our parental gene. A child who is born to Korean parents in Korea, but adopted and brought up by an English family who speaks English in United States will have physical features of his parents that he has inherited from his genes, but his language would be English, that is, inherited from the culture in which he has been brought up. Dear students, the next quality or characteristic of human language that we would study is duality. Duality means that language operates at dual system level, layers or dual layers simultaneously. This property is called duality or double articulation. For example, if we see at the minimal units of human sounds or phonemes like N, B, E as individual sounds, none of these discrete forms have any meaning. In a particular combination, when these very sounds N, B and E joins, it may become bin or it may become nib. So these two different combinations of the same sounds have different meanings. So we can say we have phonemes, and those phonemes may combine in multiple ways in order to find meaningful units of language. And the systematic arrangement of these phonemes can alter the meaning of the chunks of language as well, as it has happened in the case the combination of same sounds n, b and I in nib, n, b and e in nib has different meaning to the same sounds in bin. So this is the duality of the language at the level of phonetic system. This duality of levels is in fact one of the most economical feature of human language, because with a limited set of discrete sounds we are capable of producing very large number of sound combinations or words which are distinct in meaning. A clear example can be, there are 44 phonemes in English language, and these 44 phonemes can combine to form millions and billions of words. Simultaneously, the languages have limited number of graphic symbols to represent their phonemes, and these graphical symbols form billions of volumes of books. Not only at the phonemic or morphological level, these combinations are formed and they join to make different sets of meanings. They also are formed at grammatical level or at all the levels of language analysis. For example, the sentence Ali ko saanp ne kaata and another sentence Ali ne saanp ko kaata, both of these sentences are combined of the same words or the same basic units, but they have an entirely different range of meanings. Only the substitution at the level of the words within the same sentence boundary has changed the entire meaning, the context and the setting of the language chunk. Language is systematic, and this term implies that there is a high level of systematicity in language, and language operates in terms of well-organized hierarchical structures. Hierarchical structures here mean that all the systems have their minimum units, and from that minimum units they join up to make the higher level units, and from those higher units they make up to form the greater or higher units. In FERT's terms, we can say that language is polysystematic. If we want to give examples of some of its systems, we can say all the languages have their own syntactic, semantic, phonetic, pragmatic, morphological systems, and these systems have their minimal, higher and higher units, and all these units varies in different languages. For example, in English language, if we want to analyze the morphological system, we would find there would be morphemes, then there would be stem or root words, and there would be prefixes or suffixes, and they form to make words. Similarly, in grammatical or syntactic system, there would be verbs, nouns, adjectives, helping verbs, pronouns, and a number of different grammatical categories that join up to make sentences. And these sentences form different paragraphs as their higher categories. So all these systems work in collaboration to make the language meaningful and comprehensible, And no language can operate without this systematic effect or systematicity. Another feature of human language is that it is primarily speech. This means that speech was the initial form of human language. And the speech was made up of the vocal sounds produced by physical articulatory mechanism of the human beings. And the written form or the writing was a later development. This later development was actually started as a mean to keep a record of the spoken form, but gradually it has developed and now it has gained its highly systematized graphical symbols, and it seems to have acquired the status of a maturer version, even more effective than the spoken one. All the information is available in the written form, and all the knowledge is being transmitted in the written form. All the international communication is being carried out in the written form. However, we, being the students of linguistics, should not forget the fact that language is basically or primarily speech. Written language is a later representation or development of that speech. Students, the next quality of language that we are going to discuss is arbitrariness. This quality was also discussed in yesterday's lecture. Since the first slide was missing, it was not understandable to the students. So I am going to explain it again. Arbitrariness is the quality of language that describes the fact there is no natural connection between language form and its meaning. For example, the linguistic form dog has no natural or iconic relationship with that hairy four-legged creature that exists in this world. This aspect of relationship between linguistic signs and objects in the world is described as arbitrariness. We can explain this phenomenon by relating a famous saying that meaning lies in people, not in words. Words are just like empty vessels. What we put in them would be their meaning. So, the meaning of any certain term would be what a majority group of the society associate with that term, and that association is determined by society on the arbitrary basis. It has no fixed rules. However, there are some words in language with the sounds that seem to echo the sounds of the objects or activities, and they seem to have less arbitrary connection. For example, in English language, cuckoo, crash, slurp, squelk, and burr. All these words exemplify the object or the activities they represent. However, this feature of arbitrariness, of being less arbitrary, is not inherited by human languages. It is mostly represented by animal language. Okay, students, so over from my side for this topic. Now I am going to assign you an activity. The activity is make a comprehensive assignment on the topic characteristics of human language. Prepare it in your own words. Try to write smaller sentences of your own. My priority would be your personal expression of language, although it may be faulty one. So, marks would be awarded according to your personal expression, and the criteria would be faulty expression would be preferable to the copied expression. And the last step is to add 5 sentences as examples of each property of language. You can go for reading to George Yule's book that is recommended in your syllabus, and you can also consult the book that has been prescribed in the classroom to get the information about the topic. However, the written material should be entirely in your own words. Thank you.